Okay, thank you, Nitin, for the talk. So any, we'll be taking questions.
What is the cost of doing this compared to just simply 3D printing the same shape or?
We have not compared 3D printing with this. I don't know how to exactly use 3D printing for producing a plastic sheet with our desired shape. But of course, you can use all kinds of methods. It's not the only method. I can't tell you about the cost, though. This is very cheap because all that is required is your laser printer and the piece of plastic. This shrinkage ink is not very expensive. So all that you have to do is to print it and heat it.
Sir, in R-Cube, are there any other types of rigid surfaces other than a sphere? Because I could not think of any one.
To give you straight away a very trivial answer, any dense open subset of sphere will still be rigid.
Yes, sir, but like...
But I expect that many other convex closed shapes are likely to be rigid.
I see. Okay.
There are books devoted to embedded hypersurfaces in Euclidean spaces of all dimensions. You can...
All right. Thank you.
...the answer.
Using this method, can we somehow take a curved surface and convert it into a flat surface?
Okay. Good question. The answer is this. Suppose you have material which does not permanently remain contracted as this one does, but you have a way of changing it. Then you will be able to produce changing shapes. Then you have that and then you... It's like they're tailoring and there's something called alter tailor, right? They're these shops. They take your old clothes, they no more fit, then they modify them. And so if there's a, it depends on material which you are able to again and again contact or expand. Then you can.
Okay. Thank you.
If you print and say not a dark black or like something like a gradient, then does it...
Very good question. And so we tried it. In fact, the first version of this preprint began. So after I thought of tailoring as the obvious idea, my next thought was this, that any of these surfaces are actually conformal to the flat one. And so they are obtainable through an appropriately chosen phi, which changes circles into circles but has a factor. So I thought, why not shade the plastic? The intensity of shading will vary according to the factor of contraction we want, and then we'll get it. The reason it didn't work was the response of the shrinkage to heating is very, very nonlinear. Below a certain threshold, it doesn't. Above that, it certainly does a lot. So to get it precisely became impossible. We tried to get over it by, instead of continuous shading, having a polka dot pattern. So each polka dot is of a size which will heat sufficiently and will contract completely, but the density of these dots will change. This again didn't work for a very interesting reason. This black dot which is surrounded by white, the white thing doesn't contract, while the black does, and it melts, and then tears develop. And so very undesired effects emerge when a small black thing is completely surrounded by white. So this continuous shading, as well as polka dot, does not work for these reasons. Yeah.
So the pictures you showed, the surfaces produced were very imperfect. You know, you wanted something and you didn't get it quite right. So for applications, it doesn't seem to be really useful.
Not in the form that we have. I don't think any commercial people will use what we have made. But, you know, my understanding of any commercial process is they take the idea and then they work it out and then they only want one particular shape for their product. And for that shape, they readjust the parameters. Because very many nonlinear unexpected things happen in this. So you fiddle with the picture and you freeze finally something which works well. Again, there's a matter of scale. We divide it into little squares and therefore there's graininess at a certain scale. You might be able to use material more refined and make that graininess on much smaller scale, and then it will look smoother. So for an actual engineering application, they'll take their desired shape, they'll, presumably if they ever want to use it, they'll fiddle a lot with it, and then freeze that design, and then they go into production. So all the various commercial products that you see, it's not like anything you make any day suddenly. They freeze their product, perfect it, and use it.
So you said that the shrinkage is a function of temperature between 95 and 100. So it should be easy to plot how it changes.
Yes,
and
it's
work
given
out
in
your
that.
Scaling like this.
All those graphs.
I was asking.
So my collaborator is a scientist.
Yeah.
He loves decimals, centigrades, and all such things. And graphs and colors, and he has plenty of dots, graphs, everything is there in our archive paper. Yeah. I cannot say what those functions are in terms of the gamma function, so I...
No, but you can take that linear function, and use it for
how shading density, right? How to control? You see, it's highly nonlinear, you see. A tiny change, you see, when you try to experimentally do something, you want it to be robust. As a technological method. This is under an infrared lamp, it is rotating. We try to heat it as uniformly as possible. But still tiny variations do take place, and they lead to unexpected big changes in the non-linear regime. So you'd rather have your technology go to the stable regime where you have predictable outcome. Somebody with more refined experimental techniques can fiddle in that in-between region.
So instead of like changing the number of polka dots per unit area, so why don't we try a grid?
So we tried shading. That's what I call shading.
Okay.
Then hash kind of thing.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, we tried all those patterns, but the response is nonlinear.
Okay.
Same problem comes.
So, but the tearing thing doesn't happen anymore, right?
No, tearing doesn't happen if I keep the dots very tiny, for example. But then. If it's very tiny, it rapidly loses heat by conduction to the surrounding, and then it doesn't heat at all.
Okay, thank you.
I should also mention that you don't want the white parts to get heated, right? Otherwise, they'll start contracting. But there's a method, there's a trick we do there. We sometimes coat the white things with another material so they don't contract. You can print that white thing with a different ink, you may say, or some such material which prevents it from contacting.
Okay, so thank you all, and with this I would like to thank Professor Nitin Nitsure for the wonderful talk, and on behalf of IISER, I would like to hand him this small memento. Thank you.